Live from the Subaru of Gwinnett Studio, CAB Incorporated presents Celebrating Powerhouse Women. Now, here's your host, Amanda Peerch.
Hello and welcome to the Celebrating Powerhouse Women series here on Business Radio X. We are excited to have you join us for this series that salutes and recognizes women that are making an impact in our community. This show is presented by CAB Incorporated. Since 1982, CAB Incorporated has been a distinguished leader in manufacturing and global sourcing, serving a variety of industries, including infrastructure, hydraulics, automotive, and rail with their precision machined iron and steel products. As a woman-owned company, CAB is proud to be the presenting sponsor of this Celebrating Powerhouse Women series. This series is also brought to you in part by McCarthy Building Companies and Cat Rangers. Today is a very special day. It is with great pleasure that I welcome our two powerhouse guests this morning. Welcome Chairman Charlotte Nash of the Gwinnett County Board of Commissioners and Carla Carraway, President of Precision Planning Incorporated. How are you ladies this morning?
Terrific. Great. Glad to be here.
Good morning.
Thank you for joining me. Chairman Nash, if you don't mind, we will lead with you.
Of course.
Awesome. And the first question that I have for you today is, tell us a little bit about your robust history as a public servant and why you find it gratifying to participate in so many ways.
Well, I'm going to have to give away my age somewhat to be able to share this. I actually worked for the state of Georgia for about a year and a half before I went to work for Gwinnett County. I spent almost 28 years as a staff person with Gwinnett County. Retired for the first time at the end of 2004, and then decided to come back as a elected official, made a run for office in 2011, and was elected and have served as chairman of the Board of Commissioners since then.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much. During the time I was a staff person, I actually was county administrator for 9 years at the end of my time with the county, but I was in the financial area before then. I was director of financial services and budget director and some other jobs in the finance area. So numbers are my game.
And you actually graduated from UGA.
That's correct.
With a degree in finance, if I'm not mistaken. I had your bio here in front of me. So what kind of led you to the finance direction? Were you passionate about numbers? Were you enthusiastic?
I started college to be a math teacher, and found that I did not have the patience to teach. Fortunately, the University of Georgia gave me the opportunity to be in the classroom of a high school early on, so I didn't get so far into my degree program it was hard to back up. Mm-hmm. And I looked for another way to use that love of numbers and settled on accounting as my major. Found out I didn't really like accounting, but I love finance.
And you were able to translate those skills,
yes,
and apply them.
Accounting is a good basic, uh-huh, for anything that you're going to do running a big organization.
Wonderful. Mm-hmm. And you were able to incorporate those skills mastered at UGA into the multitude of roles that you then held after.
That's been a basis for much of what I've done.
Very nice. Well, what inspired you to run? And tell us a little bit about your road to getting there.
Well, having spent my career with Gwinnett before I retired as a staff person, and having lived in Gwinnett all my life, mm-hmm, this community is home and it means so much to me. We had some things that happened at the county government right before the special election was called that we were not headed the right direction for a period of time, and I felt like I could help
turn it around.
Use my background with the county, understanding the community, and help deal with some of the issues that the county was facing at that time. My husband sums it up, though, by saying, I lost my mind.
Because you dove right in.
We're happy you did.
Thank you, Carla.
Well, I'd say he might have thought you lost your mind twice, because that was in 2011 that you had that special, mm-hmm, election, mm-hmm, correct?
That's right.
And then you were reelected again, mm-hmm, in 2012 to 2016.
And
so you came back for more.
That's right. But you have so much that needs to be done. One term is not enough to get even a start. So,
well, I applaud you for returning
and
putting those things into place. I know you're a mover and a shaker. I've been seeing that you've made a lot of appearances here lately. So thank you for taking the time to join us.
That's part of the job. I'm chief salesperson for Gwinnett County.
And public servant. Yeah. Oh, I'd like to rewind just a little bit, if we may, Charlotte, and tell us a little bit about when you're a 16-year-old, did you aspire to be where you're at today? Did you have any inkling that you would carry on this path?
None whatsoever. This is, even at the time I retired in 2004, I would have sworn I'd never run for office. That was not part of the life plan at any point. At age 16, I was probably the teaching career was what I visualized for myself. My dad was a big supporter of education and really gave both my sister and me the idea that teaching was the most honorable profession that exists. So that was what I would visualize at that point in time that I would be doing with my life. My sister did not disappoint my father. I did, I suspect.
I'm sure he's not disappointed at all. But your sister took the
yes,
route of being a teacher.
She taught in the Gwinnett County system for 31 years.
So she's also a Gwinnettian.
That is correct.
Very nice. Mm-hmm. Why, I very strongly doubt that you disappointed your father. And we are all beneficiaries of the great work that you've done here
it's
in
been,
Gwinnett.
It's been terrific. I couldn't have asked to be any more fortunate than what I've been to be able to do the things I've done right here at home.
In our area.
Mm-hmm.
Speak a little bit about some of the initiatives that you participate in giving back to the community.
Well, a lot of my a lot of the time that I spend related to Gwinnett County actually is in serving in roles outside the county. The chair of the county commission serves on the Atlanta Regional Commission. So that's the regional planning organization that has a lot to do with transportation and other services across the whole metro area. So I put a lot of effort into that. I learned a long time ago that the way for Gwinnett to have a voice is for someone from Gwinnett to be seated at the table.
Yeah.
And that's an important part of the role. I love local government, so that led me to be active in the Association of County Commissioners of Georgia. And I served as president of that organization, which gave me a great chance to travel the entire state. If I had any doubt about how fortunate we are in Gwinnett, that certainly reminded me of just how fortunate we were. The state is very varied across it. But, you know, some of the kinds of things that I've been able to do working with people from other parts of the state have just enriched and brought me new ideas that I could apply
Bring
here
back
in Gwinnett.
To Gwinnett. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, out of all the places that you got to visit in Georgia, what would you say was the place that you were able to bring the most back from?
Probably, well, there are bits and pieces from lots of places.
Right.
Yeah, there are, you know, many of the other jurisdictions here in the Atlanta area have lots of activity going on. Gwinnett and Cobb have always seen each other as sort of our friendly competitors with each other. Mm-hmm. So we do a lot of sharing back and forth with Cobb County. Every part of the state, I think, we can learn something from every mm-hmm. part of the state.
And I'm sure they were able to take something back that they learned from you as well.
Well, maybe so.
I'm sure they did. Speaking of that, what are some of the challenges that you face here in Gwinnett? What are some of the most critical challenges that we're facing here in Gwinnett?
Well, the top one always of my list is water. Mm-hmm. Now, that seems contradictory with all the rain that we've experienced, and most people are tired of it. But water is the limiting factor on Gwinnett's future. In fact, the entire metro area. There's really not another limiting factor of the degree that water is.
Wow. I didn't know that.
That it's definitely, from a long-term perspective, the most critical issue. Gwinnett's done a great job going back well before I ever even went to work for Gwinnett County. Some of our leaders did a great job in the past of planning and executing the creation of a good water and sewer system. Mm-hmm. But with another 500,000 people headed our way in 25 years or so, we've got to continue building capacity and making sure that there are good resources in the water area for all those folks that are going to be here.
In the population. Correct me if I'm wrong, this is totally left field, but don't we get our drinking water from Lake Lanier? Isn't that one of the resources?
Every bit of it comes from Lake Lanier. That's correct.
Which is also now flooded.
Well, it's full.
It's full.
Not a bad thing.
Not only Gwinnett pulls from Lake Lanier, but Cobb does as well, you said?
Well, Cobb takes part of its water out of the Chattahoochee. They also have the ability to take from Lake Allatoona, the basin that Lake Allatoona is in. But the Chattahoochee River is the Lake Lanier and the Chattahoochee River are the source of drinking water for most of the metro area. Yes.
Wow. Well, you taught me something new. I'm going to have to dig into the water initiatives now. Speak to the economic development office and hear some more.
It's definitely the most critical long-term issue. The traffic, obviously, our traffic congestion, the ability to move around, that's much more visible than the water, and it's certainly something that we've got to continue working on. We've got lots of improvements to the road network that are already underway. And we're regrouping on the transit issue and trying to figure out another approach to that. We've just got to continue pushing to provide mobility for the folks that are going to be here.
I would agree. You're very passionate when you speak about Gwinnett and all the initiatives.
Like I said, Gwinnett's home.
And we are lucky to have someone with your vigor behind our county. What would you say your why is, Charlotte? Why do you jump out of bed in the morning and serve our great community?
I think it starts with I'm a fixer. I like to fix problems. I can't imagine serving at another level of government and enjoying it as much as I do the local level. I get the opportunity to know that I'm making decisions that are going to address problems of the community, not just now, but for long periods of time into the future. And sometimes the thing that may lift me up on a daily basis is very simple kind of fixes. You know, I get a call from a lady who says our roadway or our ditch is washing away her daffodils. Well, you know, that's a pretty simple thing to deal with,
right.
Except in the weather we've been having here recently. Everything's washing
away.
but it's very important to that individual.
Right.
So I get satisfaction out of being able to create a better situation for that individual. And sometimes it's important to, I find that it helps me keep my motivation if I have some kind of interim success, because just as I talked about earlier, many of the things that we deal with at the local government level are very long term,
right?
And sometimes it can get discouraging. In terms of trying to make progress on some of those big long term issues. So I go look for a daffodil belt.
A small achievable.
To save.
Hey, there's nothing wrong with that. I've heard many people, lots of successful people, they have two different lists, the A list and the B list. And when everything on the A list is just so large, too big for you to tackle, start knocking off some of the things off your B list. And then you feel successful. You feel re-inspired.
It's motivation.
Yeah, to start tackling some of the things on the A list. You yourself are a powerhouse woman, and you're surrounded by many women trailblazers. I'm going to use that term moving forward.
Feel free.
It's here on your sheet. Give us some examples of some women trailblazers that you have the pleasure of working with on a regular basis.
Well, I would be remiss if I didn't mention the head of the CAB organization, Terry John Dole, inspires all of
us.
You know, if there's an individual that chose a path for herself that was not typical for a woman and has done has been so successful at it, Terry's one of those folks. So I look for individuals like her that inspire me. We've got loads of folks within the county organization. The head of our water and sewer department is a female, and that's not always typical. A typical field for a woman to be in. This lady that's sitting to my left that you're going to talk with here in a little bit is one of those folks. I mean, she's got
listening.
That's right. Carla Carraway is one of those folks. It's not just the business organization she's in, and she's riding herd on a bunch of folks. I can say this with love because my son is an engineer, but engineers sometimes take a lot of care and tending.
Care and tending. I like that.
And she's been very successful with that. But also, both Terry and Carla give back to the community in so many different ways, too. I think you'll see that with so many of the folks that we would all put on a powerhouse list of women, is they are not just focused on themselves or their business success. They are plugged into the community and what they can do to help the community.
Is that something that you've done your entire life? Because I know myself personally, when you're young in high school, you're very selfish, or most teenagers are very selfish. And it wasn't until I hit that that pivot point in college where I started really opening my eyes to the bigger picture. Would you say that you yourself were always a servant and participant, even in your early days? Or is that something that you kind of felt the jolt as you progressed throughout your career?
I was very active even as growing up as a teenager. But my folks, some of my family would probably say it wasn't totally altruistic motivations. They say I just like to be in charge.
Nothing wrong with taking charge. Naturally.
So I'd looked for opportunities to be involved I was very active in 4-H when I was growing up.
I remember 4-H.
Yeah, 4-H yeah. was a big
4-H
deal.
4-H was a big deal. Yeah,
in Gwinnett County.
Me too.
Exactly. Had the pleasure of being in 4-H when Wayne Shackelford was county extension agent. Great experience. My first public speaking experiences were with 4-H, both with project work and giving demonstrations, as it was called, and mm-hmm. then livestock judging. So,
and livestock's still a part of your life,
it
right?
It is. It is. my husband still has a small herd of cows. But you know, it wasn't necessarily that I was looking for something that specifically to give back. I may have been more selfish in my motivations, but I enjoyed it and. Mm-hmm. I hope I've grown a little bit over the years and not quite so selfish in the way I approach things.
Definitely. You're a servant forward person, and that's evident for sure. What advice would you give anyone, especially women, considering running for office, being mm-hmm. that you have such a robust history that you could share?
Well, I think most women already know this. We have to work harder. We have to be smarter. We have to know more. So that preparation, the recognition that most women have acquired over their lives, that you've got to be better prepared and better at everything, I think it makes them the perfect candidate for office. Because running for office is different from governing. A lot of the work that is done once you're in office is really about being a great student of the organization, of the needs of the community, listening to people,
listening, yeah.
Reading. There's just so much information that's provided to us as we get ready to make decisions. So I think I can think of any number of women who have the great skill set already because they've learned to do that in their own career or in their personal life.
Mm-hmm.
And the second thing I would say is don't be fearful about it. Take it seriously, but don't be fearful about it. We need more good women in office at every level of government, I believe.
To take a chance and dive in.
Well, I mean, typically we bring a different set of skills to the mix. And some of those skill sets are badly needed in many governments.
Mm-hmm. We have a different way of seeing things through the eyes of a woman. It's a little bit different than the eyes of a man.
Well, and I think we tend to listen a little better too, because like that's
yep.
That's part of how we go about managing our kids, our mm-hmm. our relationships within our family, and that's not a bad trait to have at all as a public official.
I would agree. And you touched on family really quickly. I wanted to ask you, with all of the weight on your shoulders, in a good way, for your duties and responsibilities, how do you balance work and personal life? Is there a balance? I know you mentioned you're looking forward to mm-hmm. retirement mm-hmm. upcoming, and so is your mm-hmm. husband. I imagine throughout the roles that you've participated in, that's been a real sucker of your time. So your husband probably was on the reverse side of that. Just share a little bit about how you're able to juggle the two and still find balance within your life.
Well, certainly the first thing I would mention is the great support I've gotten from my husband in this endeavor. As I shared with you before we started the show, my running for office was not at his he was not pushing me to run for office. He was a reluctant participant initially, and certainly it's taken our marriage, our lives, a different direction. But he's been my greatest supporter. Mm-hmm. I mean, he makes sure he laughingly calls himself my driver. He is the faithful attender with me of so many different events.
Yeah.
Oftentimes because I'm cramming to read my remarks that I'm
right.
supposed to give at
it. Gives
it.
You time.
Exactly. And he's a great sounding board. He has very good instincts about people and reads people very, very well. And again, he's just a great sounding board. I know that I can rely on him to be totally honest with me and tell me when I am off my rocker about something or I'm just missing something big. All of us need that kind of feedback. Yeah, we need that kind of feedback from someone in our life, because none of us can see things perfectly. But over the course of my career, I have done better at certain points in time with balancing it, but I'm looking forward to being able to focus on the personal.
Yes, mm-hmm. Taking your foot off the gas.
Yes.
Well, it's a well-deserved and well-earned retirement that you have upcoming. And I know I'd speak for everybody listening when I say thank you for your service.
Well, thank you. Again, it's been such a pleasure and honor.
Mm-hmm. Are there any parting words that you would like to leave our listeners? Any advice, tips, or tricks that you'd like to give a young professional out there listening that's looking to begin their career, or simply looking to maybe dive into the world that you are stepping out of?
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the things I would say, and I give this advice to a lot of people when they ask me similar questions, is don't fret about not having it all figured out at any point in time. I mean, my career has taken turns that I never would have imagined. If I'd been plotting it out over a course of time, I would have been at a totally different point. It evolves is the way I would say it, and be open to new opportunities.
And change.
That you may never have ever even thought about as a possibility.
So be open to what's next.
That's it.
I like that. Well, thank you very much, Chairman Charlotte Nash. I'm going to have a word from our partners here in just 1 second. We partner with, in addition to Terry, we partner with Cat Rangers, which is something that's near and dear to her heart. Mm-hmm. So we have a message from one of our partners. Excellent. Cat Rangers is saving lives of cats and kittens one paw at a time. They are the special forces of Cat Rescue, and all of their felines recover in their lovely home-like center in Buford while they wait to find their forever homes. Cat Rangers is growing rapidly and is always seeking financial and volunteer support. Please contribute by visiting catrangers.org today. All right. We love our furry friends at Cat Rangers. All those little meows. We're cracking up over here. You guys can hear us. It is my pleasure to welcome Carla Carraway. She is the president of Precision Planning Incorporated. How are you today, Carla?
I'm great. Thank you for having me.
Well, thank you for being here today. Yes, it's lovely to have you both. We'll start with a little bit about what Precision Planning is and how you began the company.
Okay, well, Precision Planning is an engineering, architectural, and surveying company, and we're Gwinnett based, and we're 37 years old, and we've been in the city of Lartsville in Gwinnett County for that entire time. I actually did not start the company.
You didn't?
I am pretty old, but I'm not quite that old. So it was actually founded by Randall Dixon, who is another old Gwinnett County guy that has been around for a long time. I have worked for the company for 30 years. It's been my only job.
Congratulations.
I know, right? Uh-huh. You don't hear that very often. No. And people always say to me, you don't hear that very often. But I'm, like Charlotte, I'm a Gwinnett County native. I grew up here and went to high school here. I did go to college. And so when I was looking for it, well, actually, I was an intern with Precision Planning while I was in college. And that was not by choice. And that was sort of one of those situations of, like Charlotte was saying, if you're plotting out things, that wasn't plotted for me. That was a parent initiative. And that is some more the scenario. Sometimes it's not about what you know, it's about who you know. And my parents were, Randall Dixon and my dad were old bird hunting buddies. Oh. And so my dad, when I was a senior in high school, said, you know, I think you need a summer job. And I said, oh, no, I'm going to hang out at the lake all summer. And he said, no, I think you need to, you know, we need something to do with your time before you're going away to school, right? So Precision Planning was started in 1982. And so this was 1985, and I'm going to date myself as well. And so it was a really small, just starting company. And if you think about what Gwinnett was like in the early to mid-80s, it was a lot smaller. Obviously, it's not the urban, cool place it is now, right? And so, you know, that company was just getting started. And so, and I was not, had any intention of being an engineer architect. I, at that time, had no idea really what I wanted to do. I didn't even really know what companies like that did. So working there every summer while I was in college is how I figured out what went on in companies like that and what they do, you know, for local communities, right. which is where the majority of our business happens, is with local communities. Right. So anyway, that's, you know, sort of how I got my start there.
What did you intern as, if you don't mind me asking?
Well, everything. Okay. Again, it was a small company. And so I did everything from one summer I was the receptionist, mm-hmm. which was a great way to learn about the company. Mm-hmm. Another summer, I was an administrative assistant, and I actually worked for three engineers that are still there. They were young professionals at the time, and they had, at the time, people were moving over. I know you at your age are going to find this impossible to believe, but they were moving off typewriters onto word processors, right?
Yeah.
And so I was the college student that had some experience, you know, with using word processors, what used to be called Word Perfect. Mm-hmm. So they were transferring how you type up contracts. And I know this is so hard to believe that this has truly happened, but, you know, they were typing all that stuff by hand, and they were trying to figure out how to put it on a word processor.
Yeah. You revolutionized the office.
That was my job one summer, was I helped all those poor, you know, old engineers figure out, and they weren't really old at the time, but, you know, I thought
at
they
the time,
were.
Yeah.
So anyway, so I mean, empty trash cans, answer the phone, run errands. In fact, I used to do the permits up at Gwinnett County. I would go up to the county and file the plan. So I did lots of things over those years, which is what helped me when I actually went to work there full time, which was when I graduated. I too have a degree in finance. And so engineering and architecture is not, you know, what I did, but I went to work in the finance department of that company. And so by the time I got into the finance side, I had already seen bits and pieces of the rest of the business. And so it was really easy to integrate into, now this is the money side, which we all know is a very important side, especially of a for-profit business. And as she said, the finance side's always very important.
Very important.
And that's like, that's my background too. I mean, I do lots of other stuff with my job now, but that's definitely I love spreadsheets and sitting in my office and figuring out things. I don't get to do that a whole lot anymore, but I do love it.
There's a certain satisfaction when you've created a pretty in-depth Excel document
yes.
and you've got it color-coded and you've got your tabs and you just look at it as a thing of beauty.
Exactly.
I understand that feeling, definitely. That's very exciting. So you've been with the company for 30 years and there's still people that are tenured there and
yes.
you have the great fortune of still working with. So I'd say that solidarity and retention is very important with precision planning.
It is.
How did you ascend the ranks to become the president from all of, we'll say from the intern
yes.
to the president?
It's a long
road. Was that over the 30-year span? Maybe you could tell us a little bit about some of the marks in between.
Okay. It was an interesting road. And again, like Charlotte said, if you had to plot it out, mm-hmm. I would have never ever guess that I would be doing what I'm doing now, although I really can't imagine doing anything else because it's been a great fit for me and for my life, especially growing up in Gwinnett, and not many people have the opportunity to come back and, you know, work there, work your whole career. I live here. I have a daughter that goes to Gwinnett County Public Schools. My husband's business is in Gwinnett. I mean, it's definitely a family family event.
Right.
And my parents still live here. My in-laws still live here. So we all are part of the
Gwinnett
party.
Not going anywhere.
No, we're not. So I went to work in their finance department. And Randall Dixon, who I mentioned, is the founder of Precision Planning. He was, he's still around. And he still comes in the office. But he's pretty much semi-retired mm-hmm. in the way I would term it. He still has his nose in a few things. But he, after a couple of years of working, you know, back in my office doing my own little projects, he said, you know, he's great about investing in young professionals. He believes in investing, and he was way beyond his time in investing in females in that industry. And he at one point came to me and said, you know, we need to get you out of the office more. We need to get you, you're from this area, you know a lot of people, you need to start getting involved. And the first thing I want you to do is get involved with the chamber. Mm-hmm. And you need to learn who our clients are. You need to learn who our partners are, the people that we work with, work for. And the best way to do that is to start getting out and meeting people. And, you know, I was, as much as I like to hang out and be social, I was pretty happy doing what I was doing. So I sort of fought that for a while until he pretty much just said,
go.
I'm not asking you, I'm telling you.
I asked you the first time, now
yes.
I'm telling you.
And so he was the one that said, you know, I just think that you have some potential to, you know, And I don't know that even he knew it would go where it went. But, I mean, I just think he thought there was things that I could do besides just sit and manage Excel spreadsheets run payroll and that, you know, that the type of things, operational side of the business.
Right.
So that's how it started. And it was me getting out and going to, you know, we're members of, we work for the county governments, not just Gwinnett County, but counties all over the state. We work for city governments. Those are a lot of our big clients, as well as private clients. So we partner with organizations like Charlotte was talking about, the Association of County Commissioners, Georgia, Gwinnett Municipal Association, the Georgia Association of Chiefs Police, Georgia Sheriff's Associations, all those types of people are our clients. And so we go to those conferences and work in different aspects with those groups. And so those are the types of things that I started going to.
Support,
and that's where you meet lots of people. That's where you meet the elected officials. That's where you meet the county managers, the city managers, the police chiefs, the fire chiefs, all those people that eventually you work with,
right,
you know, while you do their projects, depending on what the projects are. And so, you know, just, and when you do it, as long as I've done it, there are people that, you know, I got to be friends with. And, you know, business is about relationships.
Yes.
And it's, you know, about, I mean, obviously in the business that I'm in, you have to be qualified, right? Engineers and architects and surveyors have to know what they're doing. So we would not be doing projects for our clients if we weren't qualified. But at the same time, your clients have to trust you, right? And they have to know that you're going to do what you say you're going to do, as well as do it correctly. It's a twofold event. So that's sort of my role. What became my role over the years was those relationships and knowing people and being the face of precision planning that gives back to the community. And we're big on that. We're big on being a part of this community, especially because we're based here. But a lot of the communities we give back in different ways in all the communities that we work in.
Right.
So anyway, so over the years, and I've been the president since 2009. That's about the time that Mr. Dixon decided he was going to start stepping away and getting out of the day-to-day stuff. And we have a great, it's not just me, there's a great team of people. We have 75 employees. The five people that I would say is part of our senior leadership team we all have 15 plus years at Precision Planning. So we've all been there a long time, worked together for a long time. And there's another female that runs our architecture department. And then there's a couple of guys that are in the engineering side and the business development side. It's a great group of people. And I think the fact that we all have such a great
relationship
from long term of working together, that makes a big difference too.
Yeah, I'd say, because it's like you're going to work with your family kind of.
Yeah, and we're friends. I mean, we're friends. We all socialize outside work, aside from working together. And that's, you know, that makes a big difference. If you like what you do and you like the people you work with.
You never work a day in your life. My whole life. I'd like to rewind. You mentioned some of the initiatives in giving back with precision planning, and that's very important in all the communities. Are you able to share with us a little bit about a specific initiative here in Gwinnett that you guys might participate in?
Well, I mean, we participate in a lot. It would be hard for me just to say one thing. We give back in a couple of different ways. One is, like I mentioned, it's me. A lot of times people see me because I might serve on a board of organizations, or I might be the one that is at a ribbon cutting,
which is all a donation of your time.
Right.
Definitely.
Well, but it is part of my position, right? Because that sort of comes under what I do. But then there's things that we do, you know, that maybe aren't so public, shall we say, where we might support a particular organization financially, or we might send a group of our employees might go and participate in, like, for instance, I sit on the board of Gwinnett Clean and Beautiful, and I have for years and years. Very and nice. So Gwinnett Clean and Beautiful actually partners with Gwinnett County Water Resources Department about doing stream cleanups and watershed cleanups. And obviously, we have a vested interest in that we do that type of work. So it's kind of a relationship event. So we'll put 17 or 18 employees together, and they bring their families, so that, like, children can come. So when you talk about learning how to give back to your community, if you have teenagers, they get community service hours for their school.
Yep.
So it's kind of a win-win for everybody. And that'll be a Saturday morning where they're cleaning litter out of a stream.
Yeah. That's
so
exciting.
You know, I mean, that's not exactly writing a check, or that's not me sitting on the board,
impactful.
But it's a give back in certain ways. I also you know, give back to, like I said, my daughter goes to Gwinnett County Public Schools, so I sit on boards, PTA boards, school cluster foundation events, so things that affect the community, but it's more, you know, for because of where I live.
Right. I understand. All still relevant and valid. Yes. Well, thank you for all of the participation. You mentioned your school-age children, and I'll ask you something similar to what I asked Charlotte. 30 years with Precision, and you have a family as well. How do you balance? How do you find time for yourself? You look so beautiful when you came in here today.
That's sweet.
You look put together. I would look disheveled.
No, I feel disheveled
thinking about it. Share some of the keys to your success in balancing personal and professional life.
So it's hard, like Charlotte said, and some days it's harder than others. I will say that I am extremely blessed because my family, I have my in-laws and my parents are both retired and live in Gwinnett, and so I don't really know how people with children do it without their families or work full-time like I do, do it without their families, because you know, they help out a lot, and so if I get caught or I have somewhere to be, then you know, my parents and Tommy's parents are an easy phone call or a text away to take my daughter places. I'm also I'm an old mom. I started way late in life, and there's good and bad in that.
With that comes wisdom.
Well, there's pros to it, and then there's cons to it. So I worked for a long time, and my career was very established before I ever had a baby.
Out of the family aspect.
And, you know, so that makes a difference, that I was not fighting that, trying to get where I wanted to be with my career and trying
and
to figure out how to raise a child. And I just have one child. She's now 13.
Teenager.
She's an eighth grader. Yes, she's an eighth grader, and that's another whole realm that we don't need to get into, but
bless you.
But she's a great kid. But I do think she's great, but she's grown up having a working mom. I mean, I've always worked, and so she understands. She's very independent, and that's been a goal of mine. My mom made sure I was a very independent person, and I've made sure that she's very capable of functioning. Obviously, my husband's great, right? He's real easygoing. He's, you know, nothing bothers him, which is a really good thing. But he's great about stepping in and helping out and doing whatever needs to be done, too. But she also has learned over the years how to be independent, and she just doesn't know any different, right? I just think kids that their moms have always worked, they just understand.
It's a fact of life.
That's just part of, you know, how we shuffle all that around. And but, you know, I keep a very well-organized calendar, color-coded.
Of course.
Yes. And the fact that I, you know, work close to where I live. I mean, I live 6 miles from my office. Mm-hmm. And that's a huge difference when I'm not in the traffic party going back and forth to downtown Atlanta. I mean, I can run back and forth to my house, to her school, you know, wherever I need to go, and it's pretty easy, you know, for me. Not that there's not traffic in Gwinnett, there certainly is.
Oh, yes.
You have to pick the times of day that you do that. But I think it's the combination of having an employer that was always understanding, even before I was the one that helped establish the policies and procedures. And they've always been, Precision Planning is a very flexible company. They understand that employees have families, they have personal lives. And you know, in order for them to do what you want them to do as an employee, you have to be flexible and you have to be understanding of things like that. So I've always had the flexibility to come and go, you know, and I don't abuse the privileges, right? You kind of understand there's certain things that I have to do. But I think it's the combination of all those things. So, you know, I'm probably a little bit of an exception to the rule because I have all those
resources.
Abilities to do things that I like to do and have great job in the process.
Well, that's very helpful because a few things stood out in what you were mentioning, and that was having a good support system and organization. So I'd say those two things were pretty paramount in your success and even to this day, because we still juggle every single day.
Yes.
That brings me to my next question. You're very passionate about what you do and passionate about being a mother and all of the things that you do to give back. Much like I asked Charlotte, what is your why? Carla, why do you jump out of bed in the morning? What gets you going every day? What is your inspiration to just leap up and do?
Well, and you know, that's probably changed over the years as I've gotten older. And, you know, I think the reasons I did that, you know, when I was young and first started my career, and I remember at one point when I first started when I first went to work for Precision Planting right out of college, you know, things sort of are, things are a job, right? You need to get a job, right? My parents were like, you need to get a job. You need to get off of our payroll. We were talking about earlier before we started about, you know, they provided me with an education and they were, I was very grateful to them. But at the same time, they were like, it's time for you to get on your own. So, you know, you get a job and, you know, I honestly, you know, did coming back to Gwinnett interest me in 1989? Not really. Mm-hmm. Gwinnett, again, was not the cool urban community that it is today. Yeah. And it's an awesome place to live. And I grew up here and it was an awesome place to grow up. But it's very different than it was then. And there's pros and cons to everything, mm-hmm. right? But at you know, when I was 22, at that point, you know, it was all my friends were living in Atlanta. I went to school at Emory University of Atlanta. And so a lot of my friends were state Atlanta. They were moving to Chicago or New York or, you know, Texas and in Dallas. And I was thinking, I don't really want to go back to Gwinnett. You know, I mean, that's just not, it just didn't sound very cool. But in all reality, I thought I was going to be a flight attendant for Delta. I mean, we were talking about Delta because that sounded very cool and fun. And my dad was looking at me like, have you lost your mind? You know, why would you?
At that time, those stewardesses were like very in. Well, I mean, everybody, they wore the cute little outfits.
Yes, yeah, exactly. And, but, you know, here I was that I had interned with this small and growing company. And my parents were very influential in saying, okay, if you really want to be a flight attendant, that's great. But you've been offered this, and I had been offered a job at Precision Planting in their finance department. And I just remember my dad saying, why wouldn't you at least try this? You can live at home for free. I'm thinking, I don't know if that's a pro.
That is a major pro these days.
I like my parents. I did like, I still like my parents. I did even then. But, you know, there was just the things he was rolling out weren't exactly what a 22-year-old,
right,
you know, that's been living on their own for 4 years all of a sudden wants to hear. But, you know, I do like my parents and I trust them. So I did listen. And obviously we all know the end result, which was a great decision on my part to listen to them, because I did go to work for this company that was a small, you know, getting started and, you know, had became very successful over the years. And I was part of that.
Yeah,
and then, you know, have come into another role in the last 10 years. And this company's in another place because, you know, where our office is located is is in another place. So it's provided opportunities for Precision Planting that I don't even think Randall Dixon thought was going to happen when he started it in 1982, right? I don't think any of us thought we were going to go some of the directions that we've gone. But things, you just roll with the punches and you take, you know, advantage of the opportunities. And so that's, you know, that's what I've done. It's interesting, you know, how you get to where you're going
ultimately. Yeah. And then we just keep going and going and going. Yes. It's another chapter.
Yes, exactly.
I always like to use the reference, and it might not make sense because things visually in my mind don't come out the right way, but you know when you're going up a flight of stairs, like in an apartment complex, you go up some stairs and you come to a landing. You go up some stairs, you come to a landing. That's kind of how I view life. You know, we might be on a 7-year stretch up those stairs and you might just stay on that landing for 3 months. You might stay there for 3 years, 30 years even, but you never know what's at the top of that next staircase and how long you'll stay at that landing.
Right.
That's very exciting. Well, I know that there's great things ahead for you at Precision, especially with you at the helm and all the growth.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome. You spoke about networking and how important it is to to kind of ramp up those relationships, especially for selling and not only retention. Mm-hmm. What are some groups that you participate in for networking that you find value in?
Wow. Well, there is Gwinnett and the Metro Atlanta area provide just tons and tons. You almost have to pick and choose. I mean, I could almost go to every a different day. Event every day. And, you know, obviously when you work, you at some point you do have to be in the office, right? I mean, even though you can be out. And the the Gwinnett business community, what I think is great about Gwinnett, and I'm sure Charlotte would agree with me on this, is that everybody in Gwinnett understands the role and that it's not just one part that can do everything, right? There's a role for government. There's a role for the school system, which is very important when you're operating a community, right? And there's a role for business. There's a role for nonprofits. I mean, there's different aspects. And so I think that what the great thing about Gwinnett is that when you go to networking opportunities, whether it's with the Gwinnett Chamber or whether it's, you know, with Gwinnett Clean and Beautiful, or whether it's Leadership Gwinnett, or whatever the different opportunities that you have to form relationships and see other people, you'll find representatives from all those groups mm-hmm. at that. You know, you'll see it's not just the same people over and over. Some of the people are the same, but some of those you'll start, like now I'm seeing more and more young professionals, which I think is fantastic. Mm-hmm. That there's people that are, you know, and we try to do that in our company. There's people that we're trying to, you know, move on up into areas and get them exposure, meeting people in our community. Right. And so, you know, and because we work in so many different communities, I will say that other, and when I say communities, that could be a county, it could be a city. Not everybody thinks the same way as Gwinnett does. Not everybody is as,
I agree,
you know, organized yes. about putting together events that everybody comes to. And they're not as well attended. Even though they might do them, they might not be as well attended. So I do go to there. We're members of lots of chambers of commerce, mm-hmm. obviously. That's usually the place you start. So there's a lot of chamber lunches, breakfast, dinners that you go to. And then there's lots of things that that you can attend, whether it's not maybe not necessarily networking, it's just a social event, but it's something to give back. You know, for like the other day, I was at an event for the Gwinnett Leadership Organization for Women, and Kendra Scott, which is right. a big jewelry.
Yep. Right?
I'm wearing
actually. Oh, very
Kendra
nice.
That I bought there. Oh, my impulse purchase. But they were there. One of their VPs was there just talking about Kendra Scott. But part of what they were doing is anything that was sold, they had a little pop up shop, but anything that was sold that day, it was actually here, right mm-hmm. down the hall. 20% went to Mosaic Georgia, which is an organization in Gwinnett that does fantastic things, that there's a need for that type of organization. And so just the fact that they, you know, took two different events and put it together so that there was a benefit and that there was ways for people to learn about, you know, a big company that if you're a female, most of you know who Kendra Scott is and whether you like her or not, but uh-huh. you know what
it's
that is.
Familiar,
so you could hear that, mm-hmm. you could network. Business community, all the different people that I was talking about. In fact, one of the Gwinnett County police officers I was talking about earlier, she was at that event on Tuesday, whenever that was. And then you had the whole Mosaic Georgia, mm-hmm. you know, crowd. So things like that is what, there's lots of things that I think young professionals and that I think anybody that's involved in the Gwinnett community, it's not hard uh-huh. to find an event to help form those relationships and help figure out, you know, where you want to go and what you want to do.
I agree. I like to keep it diversified. I enjoy all the chamber events, but I find myself going to events in neighboring cities mm-hmm. or at different chambers just to kind of see, mm-hmm. you know, there are other resources available and there are other people outside of your immediate network that can kind of help enrich what you're doing. Just out of curiosity, because I have a passion for projects in the space that you're in, are you able to share a little bit about anything that you have ongoing in the area, a project or something
projects
that you've
that
recently
we have
completed?
Well, yeah, we could spend a lot. Like when you've been somewhere 37 years, I could, yeah. And it's so funny too, so because since I live here and I drive around, sometimes I take it for granted, and then somebody will say something about a building. I'm like,
that's
a PPI project. But recently, if you see the fire stations in Gwinnett County, it's our prototype. Station 15 in Lawrenceville was recently opened, and that's, you know, that just happens to be the one that's most recent. We also do a lot of public safety work besides fire, do police. So we recently opened the brand new Gwinnett County Police Precinct at Bay Creek, which is in the Grayson community, which was a much needed and I live in that community, so I had a twofold event, right? Because I lived there, I knew it was needed, but then Precision Planning was the engineer and architect, so for me it was a win-win all the way around. Georgia Gwinnett College, we did their athletic facility, if you know the athletic city on Collins Hill Road, that was a part of ours. And actually just last week I was at a ribbon cutting for Lilburn, City of Lilburn Police Headquarters. City of Lilburn relocated there. We did their City Hall Library, which was a combination project between the county and the city, which was one of the first of its kind, I think, that was ever done that way. It was very impressive from the city and the county to get together and do that project. We did that, and then after that, the city decided to relocate their police headquarters out to Highway 29 to the main thoroughfare rather than it being down in downtown. So we just cut the ribbon on that last week. And then on the private side, I was just at a ribbon cutting this on Tuesday. We cut the ribbon on a brand new bank in Lawrenceville, First American Bank, that's Mason Athens, mm-hmm. that's located a branch in Gwinnett. They obviously see the market in Gwinnett figured out that they needed to build a branch. And so we were the architect and the engineer for that. And that just, we literally cut the ribbon Tuesday night. I was at that event. So I'm trying to think about what that's else. Exciting. Lawrenceville Police Headquarters, Lawrenceville, Sugar Hill, which is a growing area. Well, the Sugar Hill E-Center was our project, the Sugar Hill City Hall.
The whole entire E-Center?
The whole E-Center.
That is a gorgeous facility.
Isn't that a great facility?
Oh, my goodness. The
have you been up to
yes,
the...
I go to events all the time.
Yes.
They have the brew pub there.
Yes,
they
the
have
theater.
The athletic area yes. for the children. They have the networking portion.
And they have theater outside.
That's gorgeous.
Yes, we did all the... Sugar Hill's been a client of Precision Planning's for 20-plus years, so we've done work for them on and off. Obviously, never anything that... That was a huge
elaborate,
project
yeah.
for us. I mean, huge project. And we were so excited
yes.
to get that project. And it turned out fantastic. And it's had, they're doing all more, it's just stemmed all sorts of other
yes.
development up there. Right. And so.
Isn't that rewarding? You had a hand in creating
Well, I don't
something.
Know that I had a
oh,
hand
Oh, you
in
did. Your team. Okay, you're part
yes.
of the team.
So Precision it's, Planning
yes.
did.
So your stamp is on it.
Yes.
And it's a place that so many people gather and do so many
Correct.
Fun things and just so much camaraderie and friendship. And I think it's just wonderful.
Yeah,
you guys are responsible for that space.
It is. Yeah, we love to show those. We show those pictures all over our website, all over social media,
I'm
lots
sure,
of places
yeah.
we show those pictures because it is such a great,
yeah, space,
a great project.
Mixed-use space. So did you guys do the, I guess it's the Sugar Bowl? It's like where the
yeah,
concerts
the Sugar Hill Bowl.
Are? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's
yep.
very nice.
And so it's interesting when you're talking about giving back. So now we are a sponsor of that,
ah.
right? So obviously we, right. that was our project. So now we're a sponsor of that. We have a box in there. So
cool.
I go to a lot of those.
Yes.
They have great concerts.
Yes, I actually,
there.
I saw, I think it was a Bret Michaels cover
yes,
band.
Yes, like the Poison cover band.
Oh, man, they didn't,
now
they didn't
really
hold back anything there.
I love Poison.
They had the headbands. They had
yes.
the leather. It was
everything.
Great.
Yes.
But
yeah. So that was all part of, that was all, it was a tiered, you know, kind of, that project kind of mm-hmm. happened over a long period of time.
Right.
It was a vision of that city and where they wanted to go. Because Sugar Hill, like when I was growing up, Sugar Hill was it's a
such
really
a sweet
small
name.
little place. It's just amazing to mm-hmm. me what they've done up there
right.
and the vision that they've had, you know, up there.
And
so
watch it come to life.
Yeah.
Well, I have to applaud you because I very much enjoy that facility. And I think it's really nice how they have the stone that's receding into the grass. I know
yes.
that term is probably wrong. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
And then it's all ascending, you know, and you have the stage. It's all natural.
Yes.
It's all beautiful
it
and
beautiful.
Very low maintenance except for cutting the grass. So
mm-hmm.
Kudos to you and your team.
Well, I will pass that along
Please
because
do.
They're all we're all
Hopefully
proud of that,
listening.
Believe me.
So, well, before we end the show, I'd just like to ask you the same thing as I asked Charlotte. What advice would you give to a young woman or a young person out there, much like your daughter or mm-hmm. much like myself, that's looking to tackle a career maybe in your field? Because, again, like we were talking mm-hmm. about beforehand, it's typically a male-dominated mm-hmm. industry. What advice would you give them to pursue their dreams?
Well, let me just say before I answer the question. So the last two people I have hired at Precision Planning have been females.
Yay.
One architect, one engineer.
Uh-huh.
Young, 22, right out of college. Lots of potential in my mind. Just
they
from
call
all
it
that
green,
I see.
Don't they?
So there's more women, mm-hmm. I think, that you see coming into these types of fields. So I think I think that's great mm-hmm. from my standpoint. But what I would say to anybody, male or female, is to find something that you like to do. And in fact, I just had this conversation with my daughter because she's going to be starting high school where things get really real, really fast.
And very
right?
different.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And it's so, there's so much pressure on kids today at this age to know what they think they might want to do, which I think is
yeah,
ridiculous.
No
That's
idea.
Another whole, we could have another whole radio show. But what I said to her when she was trying to figure out what classes to take as a freshman, and you know, what I said to her was, listen, you know, when you as you're going through this part of your life, you're high school and then you'll go into college if that's what you want to do. I mean, you may decide to do something else, and that's fine with me, but find what you like to do, but make sure you get paid for it in some way. I'm not saying you have to become wealthy doing it, but make sure you can support yourself, right? Because
right?
you're not gonna be on my payroll forever. So but make sure you like what you do and that you like getting up and going to work every day and that you feel like that you're making a difference, right? And that, you know, there's some days that I definitely don't love what I do and I don't, you know, have a great day. But we all have days like that. And you just have to get past those and you have to understand it's the big picture, right? Because those days are few and far between, but they're there. So, you know, when people are first, I just had this conversation with the engineer that we hired. She just graduated from college in December from Georgia Southern. She has a civil engineering degree. And she was in my office doing some paperwork yesterday. And I said, well, how's it going? You know, you've been here like a month. How's it going? And she's like, this is nothing like they told me it was going to be.
This is real life. Real life experience.
And I said, well, describe it for me. What when you said that, she goes, it's like drinking from a fire hose.
Oh, yeah.
And I said, and that is not going to change. I mean, it's just so much to take in. And so when you're young, I think you have to be open-minded, right? You have to be open to, I really don't know anything, even though I have a degree in engineering, or have an architecture degree, or have an accounting degree, whatever kind of degree you have, you know, unless you're
hang
going
it on
maybe,
the wall.
Yeah, exactly.
Just hang it on the wall.
And I mean, if you're going to medical school, maybe it's right. a different, because you have a different path, mm-hmm. right? But if you're going to work in an industry, and it was like me, I really didn't know what I wanted to be. And I don't know that I really am what I thought I would be, but it just evolved right. over time. And you have to kind of be open for that. And you have to evolution. Take the opportunities and deal with them at the time, because then those will eventually open other doors, yeah. right? And so that's, you know, I guess it's one, enjoy what you do, you know, find something you like to do, and then take the opportunities as they come. And you know, you have to work hard. You don't get it. Mm-mm. It's not immediate gratification by any stretch of the imagination. You have to do a good job, and you have to work hard at whatever you're doing at the time. Mm-hmm. And then eventually you'll get another job, and then you have to really get that job. And then, you know, that's how the process yeah. happens.
Very nice. Well, thank you for sharing
you're welcome.
Your words of wisdom. And I wanted to thank you both from the bottom of my heart for joining us today. I know you have busy schedules, and I thank you for taking the time out to impede your wisdom upon all of those listening, including myself.
Well, I appreciate the opportunity.
We got Mike back there with the sound effects. Thank you so much. Well, again, for those of you listening, we had the pleasure of chatting with Chairman Charlotte Nash and also Carla Carraway, and I wanted to thank you both for joining us again. Remember, you can listen to our live broadcast every Friday at 11:30 on businessradiox.com by selecting the Gwinnett Studio. Our shows are available 24/7 online on iTunes, iHeartRadio, Spotify, YouTube, or your favorite podcast app. Make sure that you connect with us on social media at Gwinnett Radio X. And I do have a really quick word before we go from some of our partners. I don't know why I'm stumbling on my words, ladies. I had too much coffee this morning. Again, this series is presented by CAB Incorporated and Terry Jondal. And this series is brought to you in part by McCarthy Building Companies. McCarthy is a community-based general contractor specializing in healthcare, education, aviation, and commercial construction projects. They are committed to helping their clients achieve their short and long-term strategic goals. The McCarthy Partnership for Women believes diverse perspectives drive better outcomes and is thrilled to support this Celebrating Powerhouse Women series. All right, until next time, folks, I am Amanda Pierce, and this has been Celebrating Powerhouse Women on Business Radio X.